The reason his brother-in-law might want Hodgson's services was not hard to fathom, so his first thought was how to avoid personal engagement. It smelled of more spilled blood, and he already had suspicions enough to keep him awake at night.
"Do you wish me to let you know where he might be found?"
This got a surprised response.
"I have no wish to deal with him directly."
"Why not?"
"Trust me when I say it would be best to do so at a distance."
There was little need to inquire whom he expected to act as intermediary. The hard look Druce was getting left him in no doubt. This was soon replaced by one that sought to imply Dinby was a soul much put upon, his voice almost a whinge.
"The matter is delicate for a man in my position. I require someone to do on my behalf, and in short order, something which I cannot do myself."
"He moves around a great deal,"
was the first excuse to come to mind, though he was given no time to expand on it.
"Of which you're hardly required to remind me, considering how much of my money he wasted in his search for..."
There was an awkward pause then. Clear evidence Carruthers did not want to employ Gerson's name. It was underlined by the slight reddening of his cheeks, which made what followed very feeble.
"You know of whom I speak."
"You intend he should pursue the same task?"
"No, no, Druce. There, the matter is closed."
As a clear lie, it could hardly be bettered, yet it was not open to challenge unless the whole tub of worms concerning the murder of his wife were laid bare. There arose once more the feeling of being trapped, yet so too did all the reasons he acted as a buffer for Denby in the past. The way to avoid a repeat lay to hand in being candid, but so did the risks.
"What is it you wish Hodgson to do now?"